नमस्ते बिटिया, माई सेल्फ जूबियन नेहा सैनी फ्रॉम फिजियोथेरेपी एंड डायग्नोस्टिक्स, ज्योति विद्यापीठ वुमेन्स यूनिवर्सिटी। हेयर आई एम गोइंग टू टेल यू अबाउट द एनाटमी ऑफ द हार्ट। हार्ट इज़ अ हॉलो कोन शेप्ड मस्कुलर पम्प। द हार्ट बीट्स एट अबाउट 2.5 बिलियन टाइम्स इन एन एवरेज लाइफ टाइम। द लेफ्ट साइड ऑफ द हार्ट पम्प्स ब्लड थ्रू एन एस्टिमेटेड 1,20,000 किलोमीटर्स ऑफ ब्लड वेसल्स, which is equivalent to traveling around the Earth's equator about 3 times. The right side of the heart pumps the blood through the lungs, enabling the blood to pick up oxygen and unload CO2. Heart pumps more than about 14,000 liters of blood in a day, or 5 million liters in a year. The position of the heart, it lies within the pericardium, in middle mediastinum, behind the body of sternum, and 2nd to 6th costal cartilages, in front of the 5 to 8 thoracic vertebrae. 1/3 of it lies to the right of the median plane and 2/3 to the left. It lies anterior to the vertebral column and posterior to the sternum. It's a small organ which is about 12 cm long, 9 cm wide and 6 cm thick. On an average, the weight is 250 grams in females and 300 grams in males. The heart rests on the diaphragm near the midline of the thoracic cavity. So here we can see the heart in the mediastinum, that is the space between the two lungs. It is the cadaveric position in which we can find the heart. In this diagram we have taken the transverse section of the thoracic cavity, in which we can find the lungs, and the space between them is known as mediastinum, and this is the heart in the anterior side, which is located behind the sternum and in front of thoracic vertebrae. The apex of heart is formed by the tip of the left ventricle and rests on the diaphragm. It is directed anteriorly, inferiorly, and to the left. And the base of the heart is its posterior surface, and it's formed by the left atrium of the heart. So this is the location of the heart in between the two lungs. So this is the base of the heart, which is the posterior surface formed by the left atrium. In the left atrium, there is opening of the 4 pulmonary veins, which is showing in the diagram. It is directed backwards and lies opposite to the 5 to 7 thoracic vertebrae. Then the borders of the heart. There are 4 borders of the heart. The right border is formed by the right atrium. Inferior border is formed by the right ventricle. Left border is formed by the pulmonary border, also is formed by the left ventricle and left auricle. And superior border is formed by the both atria. So here we can see the borders of the heart. This is superior border, this is right, inferior border, and this is left border. Then the surfaces of the heart. One is the sternocostal surface, also known as anterior surface, is deep to the sternum and ribs. Diaphragmatic surface or inferior surface is the part of the heart lies between the apex and the right border. The pulmonary or left surface is occupies the cardiac notch of the left lung. So here we can see the borders and surfaces. The anterior surface is known as the sternocostal surface, comes in contact with the sternum and the costal cartilages. So this is the posterior surface of the heart formed by the two ventricles, that is the right and the left. So this is the right ventricle and this is the left ventricle. This area forms the diaphragmatic surface. Then the sulci of the heart. We have 4 sulci in the heart, that is coronary sulcus, which marks the division between the two atria and the ventricles. It contains the trunks of coronary vessels and completely encircles the heart. Then there is interatrial groove, which separates the two atria and is hidden by the pulmonary trunk and the aorta in front. There is interventricular groove, which lies between the two ventricles. There are 2 grooves on the anterior as well as posterior side, and they mark the division between the ventricles, that is separating the right and the left ventricle. So here we can see the coronary sulcus. This is the coronary sulcus between the atria and the ventricle, and this is the interventricular sulcus on the anterior side. As we know, the heart is surrounded by the membrane known as pericardium. The pericardium has its function to restrict the excessive movement of the heart as a whole and serve as a lubricated container in which the different parts of the heart can be contract. Now, the structure of the heart coverings, the pericardium has two layers, the outer fibrous and inner serous. The inner serous pericardium again divides into two layers, that is parietal and the visceral pericardium. The outermost pericardium is a membrane anchoring the heart to the diaphragm and the sternum. Pericardium secretes lubricant. The middle layer is the myocardium. It contains the contractile muscle fiber, that is cardiac muscle fiber. Innermost is the endocardium. It lines the cardiac chamber. So these are the layers of the heart wall. The outermost is the epicardium, middle layer is myocardium, and the innermost is the endocardium. Epicardium is a thin transparent outer layer of the heart made up of mesothelium, that is simple squamous cells, and the epicardium contains the blood vessels, lymphatics and vessels that supply the myocardium. Myocardium is responsible for pumping action of the heart because it is made up of cardiac muscle fibers. These are the cardiac muscle fibers, and this is the different arrangement of the cardiac muscle fiber, that is circular as well as spiral. Then we have endocardium. It is a glistening white sheet of endothelium resting on the thin connective tissue layer. It lines the heart chambers and covers the fibrous skeleton of the walls. The endocardium is continuous with the endothelial lining of the blood vessel leaving and entering the heart. Now the chambers of the heart. We have four chambers in the heart. Two atria, these are the receiving chamber located on the superior side, and two ventricles, these are the inferior chambers, and these are pumping chambers. So this is the coronal section of the heart, in which we can see the two atria. This is right atrium, this is left atrium. This is right ventricle and this is left ventricle. This is interventricular septum. This is superior vena cava, this is inferior vena cava, aorta, and this is pulmonary trunk. So this is the original heart in which we have dissected the pericardial layers. So these are the four chambers. Now human heart has four chambers, the two atria, these are the receiving chambers, and ventricles, these are the pumping chambers. They are separated by the septum. So this is the right and the left atrium, right and left ventricle, interventricular septum. Now how blood circulates through the heart? The deoxygenated blood from whole of the body reaches to the right atrium of the heart. From here it enters into the right ventricle of the heart. From the right ventricle it is pumped into the pulmonary trunk, which transfer this deoxygenated blood to the lungs. In the lungs, purification occurs and pure blood is transferred to the pulmonary veins through the left atrium. From the left atrium, the blood is entered into left ventricle. From the left ventricle, it reaches to the rest of the body with the help of aorta. This is the systemic circulation. In systemic circulation, oxygenated blood is circulated to different systems of the body, and it involves left side of the heart. The pathway is given below, which we have discussed earlier. So this is the pathway for the circulation of the blood through the heart. This is the aortic wall. Now heart features are there. It has four chambers and the four walls. The walls include tricuspid and bicuspid wall, aortic and the pulmonary walls. So we will discuss all the chambers in detail now. The right atrium. The external features include, it is a conical muscular projection which is known as right auricle. So this part is right auricle, which arises from the anterior superior part of the atrium. A shallow vertical groove known as sulcus terminalis runs along the right border of the heart and extends between the orifices of the superior and the inferior vena cava. So between the vena cava, this is the sulcus terminalis. Then there is a rough portion in the right atrium. When we open it, this rough portion is because of pectinate muscle. and there is smooth portion of the right atrium which is known as sinus venarum. Then in between these two areas there is a division known as crista terminalis. There are following openings in the right atrium, that is superior vena cava, inferior vena cava and coronary sinus. In the right atrium we found a depression in the interatrial septum which is known as fossa ovalis. It demarcates the position of foramen ovale in the fetus. The margins of the fossa ovalis is known as limbus. In the right atrium the walls include, in the case of superior vena cava there is no wall. In case of inferior vena cava there is a wall known as the Eustachian wall. It is incompetent in adults and it is directing the inferior vena cava blood through foramen ovale in the fetus. And for the coronary sinus we have the Thebesian wall. It prevents the backflow of the coronary sinus blood during atrial systole. So this is the opened right atrium in which we can see the different structures which we had discussed earlier, that is fossa ovalis, then crista terminalis, muscular pectinati and the walls, the Thebesian wall and Eustachian walls. Then left atrium, it contains four pulmonary veins, that is two superior and two inferior pulmonary veins, and the auricle, that is left auricle. So this is left atrium having two pulmonary veins open into left atrium on each side of the posterior wall. Most part of the atrium is smooth walled and muscular pectinati, these are present only in the left auricle, that is smooth small leaf like projection from the left atrium. This is the left atrium in which we can find the left auricle which is containing muscular pectinati, due to which it becomes rough, and the opening of the pulmonary veins and the wall for foramen ovale. And in left atrium this is known as annulus ovalis. Then these are papillary muscles which are controlling the opening of tricuspid and the bicuspid wall. These are found in the ventricles. This is the diagram which is showing the comparison between right and left ventricle, sorry, atria. In this we can see right atrium receives the venous blood while left atrium receives the oxygenated blood from the lungs. Right atrium transfers the blood to the right ventricle while the left atrium transfers its blood to the left ventricle. Right atria forms the right border, sternocostal surface and the base of the heart, while left atrium forms the major part of the base of the heart. Then we come to the next chamber, that is right ventricle. It communicates with the right atrium through right atrioventricular orifice. Orifice means opening. And it communicates with the pulmonary trunk through pulmonary orifice. Right ventricle is about 4 to 5 mm in average thickness and forms most of the anterior surface of the heart. It contains the muscular bridges known as trabeculae carni, which are helpful for the conduction. The right ventricle is separated from the left ventricle by the interventricular septum. The blood passes from the right ventricle through the pulmonary wall into pulmonary trunk, which divides into right and left pulmonary arteries. So in this diagram we can see the open right ventricle in which from the right ventricle the blood is passing through the pulmonary trunk. This divides into right and left pulmonary arteries for each lung. So in the right ventricle we have the tricuspid wall. Tricuspid wall has three walls, anterior, posterior and septal cusp are there. Then it has papillary muscles also which are connected to the chorda tendini. These chorda tendini contract to prevent the tricuspid wall regurgitation. So in the right ventricle the muscular projections are known as trabeculae carni. These are the meaty ridges and they are rounded or irregular muscular columns which project from the inner surface of the right and left ventricles of the heart, and they increases the power of contraction of the heart. So here we have moderator band, which is also known as septomarginal trabecula, which is a muscular band of heart tissue. In this diagram we can see in the right ventricle this is the moderator band which is containing the right bundle branch. Now we come to the left ventricle.
The left ventricle is the thickest chamber of the heart. It is about 10 to 15 millimeter thick. And from here, the blood passes to the aortic wall into the ascending aorta, from ascending aorta to the coronary arteries, which are the branches from ascending aorta. Also from ascending aorta, the blood is transferred through the whole of the body, through descending aorta and the abdominal aorta. So this is the right ventricle containing the bicuspid wall. The anterior and the posterior cusp are found, and these are the anterior and the posterior papillary muscles, and this is the thread-like structure known as chorda tendini, which is controlling the opening and closing of these valves. Now these are the differences between right and left ventricle. It is very important. The right ventricle receives deoxygenated blood from the right atria, and the left ventricle receives oxygenated blood from the left atrium. The wall of right ventricle is thin in comparison to the left ventricle. In the right ventricle, we have 3 papillary muscles, while in the case of left, we have only 2 papillary muscles. In the right ventricle, we have moderator band, which is absent in left ventricle. The cavity of the right ventricle is concentric in shape and circular in left ventricle. So this is the transverse section of the ventricles, in which we can see the thickness and the shape of the ventricles. Now the great vessels of the heart. In the heart, we have 4 great vessels like aorta, pulmonary trunk, superior and the inferior vena cava. In the diagram, we can see the superior inferior vena cava, the aorta and the pulmonary trunk. Now the conduction system of the heart. The heart contracts and relaxes by itself with the help of autorhythmic cells. These cells fire spontaneously and act as pacemaker and form conduction system for the heart. It contains SA node, AV node, AV bundle, right and left bundle branches, which splits into Purkinje fibers. SA node is a cluster of cell in the right atria, and here begins the heart activity that spreads to both the atria, shown in the diagram. Excitation spreads to AV node. From AV node, which is located in the interatrial septum, transmits the signal to the bundle of His. Bundle of His is present in the interventricular septum. Then the bundle of His divides into right and left bundle branches, which enters into right and left ventricles. These bundle branches again divides and forms Purkinje fibers. These fibers conduct the signals quickly to the ventricular muscles and make them contract. So this is the conduction system of the heart. With the help of arrow, we have demarcated the flow of conduction from SA node to the Purkinje fiber. Now this is the aorta. Contains the parts of aorta, which is the ascending aorta. Ascending means this upward portion. This is ascending aorta, this is arch of aorta, which is forming the arch-like structure. And this is the descending thoracic aorta, when it comes in the thoracic region. This is the base of aorta, in which we find the 3 cusps. So there are 3 semilunar cusps. Between the wall of the aorta and the cusp, we have this space. This space is known as sinus. In the sinus, we have small openings. These are the openings for the coronary arteries. These coronary arteries supplies the wall of the heart. So in the blood supply of the heart, we have right and left coronary arteries. The right coronary artery arises from the right aortic sinus, and it travels in the right coronary sulcus. Right coronary sulcus is present between the right atria and the right ventricle. So this is the right coronary sulcus, and this is left coronary sulcus. In the right coronary sulcus, we have right coronary artery, and the left coronary sulcus, we have left coronary artery. So these coronary arteries, they are supplying the wall of the heart. These are the branches of the right coronary artery: right marginal, posterior interventricular, sinoatrial nodal artery, and atrioventricular nodal artery. Then the left coronary artery arises from the left aortic sinus. Aortic sinus we have discussed in this diagram. This is the right aortic sinus, and this is left aortic sinus, giving origin to different coronary arteries. From the right aortic sinus, we have origin of right coronary artery. From the left aortic sinus, we have origin of left coronary artery. So this left coronary artery arises from the left aortic sinus and it is branched into LAD, that is left anterior descending artery, and circumflex artery, also left marginal arteries. This is the left coronary artery. Now dominance, it is defined by the branch that gave rise to posterior interventricular artery. So either right or left, which is providing posterior interventricular artery, the dominance is of that artery. So in case of right dominance, posterior interventricular artery arises from right coronary artery. In case of left dominance, posterior interventricular artery arises from left coronary artery. In co-dominance, posterior interventricular artery arises from both, that is right as well as left coronary arteries. Then this is the venous drainage of the heart. In this you have to learn only the names of the veins which are draining the venous blood from the wall of the heart, that is coronary sinus, which is the largest vein of the heart, then the great cardiac vein, middle cardiac vein, small cardiac vein, oblique vein of left atrium, and posterior vein of left ventricle. So these are the veins on the anterior surface and these are the veins on the posterior surface. Now the innervation of the heart. Innervation, that is the nerve supply. Heart is supplied by the sympathetic as well as parasympathetic innervation. Parasympathetic innervation is via 10th cranial nerve, and these nerves slows down the beating of the heart, that is they slows down the heart rate, while sympathetic stimulation is via thoracic spinal nerves from T1 to T4 and they increases the heart rate. Then the heart sounds, auscultation. There are two heart sounds is there. First heart sound is known as LA, is because of the closure of the atrioventricular walls, and second heart sound is created because of the closure of semilunar valves. Now the applied anatomy. One is aortic regurgitation. The blood leaks back into the left ventricle during ejection into the aorta, and it is because the volume overload in the left ventricle which leads to its hypertrophy and dilatation of the left ventricle. So this is the aortic valve regurgitation, because the valve are not competent in this case. And the treatment includes valvuloplasty, in which we replace the walls of the heart. Second is atherosclerosis. In this, the lipids build up on inside the vessels of the heart, inside the vessels of the vessels which are surrounding the heart, and they become calcified, and these vessels become hard and brittle. The causes are cigarette smoking, high fat cholesterol diet, and hypertension. So this is the case of atherosclerosis. Then we have myocardial disorders like myocardial infarction, also known as heart attack. In this, the coronary thrombosis or clot occurs, which will lead to occlusion of the coronary artery. And we all know that coronary artery is supplying the heart tissue, and because of blockage of the coronary artery, the heart tissue is deprived of oxygen and nutrition, which will lead to cell death. The signs and symptoms include the angina pectoris. Angina pectoris means the severe chest pain resulting from the inadequate oxygen to the myocardium. And the treatment includes the surgery, that is coronary artery bypass surgery. This is the myocardial infarction, leading a huge damage of the muscle. Now the questions related to this topic. First is chambers of the heart. This is a large question, long question, in which we have to describe all the chambers of the heart. Then second is blood supply of the heart. In this we include arterial as well as venous drainage of the heart. Third is myocardial infarction, in which we have to discuss about the heart attack. This is the exercise for your file. In this you have to draw this well-labeled diagram of the heart and label all the unlabeled structure which are figured out in this image. This completes your topic, the anatomy of the heart. Thank you.